The Chagalya Upanishad presented by Svayam Prakash Sharma. The Chagalya Upanishad is part of the Yajur Veda. In this Upanishad, through a series of questions, issues such as whether birth determines a Brahmin, whether the essence of man is to be seen in his body or in his soul are discussed by the sage Chagalya in the form of a story. By reconciling the two, the Upanishad arrives at the basic thought that while the body alone is born, the essence of a man is to be seen in his soul, in his Atma, and not in his body. Source material for this upload has been taken from 60 Upanishads of the Ved by Paul Doyson. The Upanishad. It so happened that once the rishis, the sages performed a sacrifice on the banks of the river Saraswati. Among those who sat for the sacrifice was a Brahmin, probably by the name of Kavas Elus. Before the sacrifice could begin, some among the rishis objected to his presence at the sacrifice, saying, "His mother is a maidservant, and since it is against the rules that such a one be present at the sacrifice, we should exclude him from participating in the sacrifice." On being so targeted, Kavas Elus asked the assembled rishis, "Venerable sirs, you who are knowers of the Ved and who are veteran sacrificers yourself, please let me know what this greatness is that you speak of. Which greatness is there in all of you, but which is not there in me?" To which the rishis replied, "Our greatness is that we are all born as Brahmins." To which Kavas Elus countered with this question, "What is that Brahmin in all of you, which is not supposed to be there in me?" The rishis replied, "He who is born in a Brahmin family, and who performs the works of a Brahmin, works that are laid down in the Vedas, he is a Brahmin." "Very well," said Kavas Elus, "let us test your argument." He led the rishis to a corpse that was lying on the bank of the river, which was that of a descendant of the sage Atri. He then asked the rishis, "Look at this corpse who lies here dead. He is a Brahmin who has performed all the works of a Brahmin as laid down in the Vedas. Now tell me, why this corpse is not called a Brahmin? If all of you regard the body as a Brahmin, then surely you must regard this corpse as a Brahmin too, for the works have not departed from the body." The rishis replied, "We do not know what has departed from the body, after the departure of which we no longer call him a Brahmin." Then Kavas Elus said, "There was a holy place in the Naimis forest where the Brahmins once performed a sacrifice. This dead person, who was a descendant of the sage Atri, he was present there at that sacrifice as one of the sacrificing Brahmins. He knew all the knowledge and he performed all the works. I ask all of you, what has become of that knowledge of his?" The rishis did not know this. They were confused. They then approached him as pupils and said, "We do not know this. Please take us as your pupils and teach us." Kavas Elus smiled and said, "You must surely know, venerable sirs, that it is against the custom that a lower person take higher and more noble-born persons as their pupils." To which the rishis replied, "If that is the case, then do not take us as pupils. But please, sir, advise us as to where we should go to learn about this." Then Kavas Alus told them, "Go to Kurukshetra, where you will find people who live like children, who are gathered there. Go to them. They will impart the truth about this to you." So, as advised by Kavas Alus, the rishis went to Kurukshetra, where they found those persons who live like children. As the rishis approached them, they asked the rishis, "What do you want? You must know that we live like children. Why have you come to us? All of you are old, all of you are wise and great, and all of you are well versed in the Vedas. There are others like you too here in Kurukshetra who are also old, who are also wise, and who are also very well versed in the Vedas, besides being very rich. Why do you not go to them instead of coming to us?" When the rishis heard this, they were again confused. They looked at one another and said to them, "There was a person whom we wanted to exclude from the sacrifice because he was born to a maidservant. He posed a question to us, which we could not answer. And when we asked him to take us as his pupils and teach us, he declined, saying that it was against the custom for a lowly person to take higher, noble-born persons as pupils and advise us to come to you. Trusting his advice, we have come to you." Then the childlike ones asked the rishis, "What do you want from us?" And then the rishis said to them, "When the Brahmins performed a sacrifice in the Nemis forest, there was among them a Brahmin descended from the line of sage Atri, who had all the knowledge and who performed all the works. Now after his death and his body having fallen down, what has become of this knowledge of his?" The childlike ones replied, "Dear sirs, there is a custom among us that has been handed down to us by our ancestors from generation to generation that we do not admit anyone as pupils unless they have served us well for at least 1 year. If you are willing to stay here and serve us for 1 year, then we could admit you as pupils and teach you." The rishis readily agreed. They remained at Kurukshetra for a year and served the childlike ones with complete devotion. At the end of 1 year, satisfied with their service, the childlike ones said to the rishis, "Now that you have served us well for 1 year, we will admit you as pupils and teach you." Then they took the rishis by the hand and led them along a pathway where horse-driven cars passed by. Then they asked the rishis, "O you lovers of truth, what do you see?" The rishis replied, "What do you want us to see?" "The horse-driven cars," they said. "We do see the horse-driven car, but why do you want us to see it?" Then the childlike one said, "Just as the horses that draw the car spring and run like the sea waves, in the same way the cars also spring and run like, just like them. Whichever way the horses go, the cars goes the same way and brings the passengers to the destination. This is how it happens." To which the rishis responded, "So it is." And all travel by the car till they reach their destination. Then a driver pulled up a car, got down from it, and unharnessed the horses. The childlike ones then asked the rishis, "Look carefully. Now that the horses have been unharnessed from the car is now like a mere piece of wood, standing still, not running, not moving. What is it that has left the car? So that, instead of running, it stands motionless." The rishis replied, "The chariot driver has left the car." At this, the childlike one said, "Just as you are seeing the car standing motionless, after the car driver has left it. In the same way, O lovers of truth, this body also becomes motionless after the soul, after the jeev Atma has left it. Know this, it is the soul, it is the jeev Atma that moves the body. The senses are the horses that pull the car of the body. The sinews are the ropes which hold the parts of the body together. The bones are the wooden parts. The blood is the oil which one drips in so that it could move the car smoothly. The work is the stick with which one drives the horses. The speech is the rattling of the car, and the skin is its covering. And just as the car driver leaves the car, as a result of which the car is rendered motionless, in the same way also, the soul, leaving the state of wakefulness, goes into the state of dream. And then, leaving the state of dream, the soul goes into the state of deep sleep, the state of sushupti, which is the state which is of the nature of perception, which is of the nature of knowledge, which is of the nature of pragya. And finally, when the soul leaves this body, leaves this state also, and liberates itself, and does not return here on earth anymore, and sets the body free, then this car of the body stands still and motionless. It does not creak. It does not make any sound whatsoever. Instead, it gives out a foul smell. People do not touch it. And dogs, crows, jackals, and other carrion lacerate the body. Then the rishis understood what the truth really is, and that it is that it is the soul with whose departure the body becomes a corpse. They understood that the body is low and the soul is high, and that the body can never be called high and the soul can never be called low. When the rishis had understood this truth well, they touched the feet of the childlike ones and said, "In truth, we have nothing good that we can offer to you, sirs, as a gift to equal what you have taught us. We stand here respectfully before you with folded hands." The Rishi Chagaleya told this story and said these mantras of the Vedas. Just as a car without a driver does not run, rattle or move, so also the body does not run, rattle or move when the departing soul leaves the body. And just as the implements of a car are idle and useless without a driver, in the same way, the organs of the body are idle and useless without the soul. And even though everyone mourns for their dead, still, by doing so, they accomplish nothing that is of use to the dead body. Yes, they accomplish nothing that is of use to the dead body. This concludes the Chagaleya Upanishad. Om Shanti, 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 Om.